Hello, everybody, and welcome to the weekly recap show for the Aegis. We have just finished our second week of playoffs, and we now have our top four. And with me is a representative from each of the four teams. The first off, we have Bajatok from BBBSS.
Hello.
Then we have Dr. Chekov from Red Pup Games.
Hello, hello.
Then we have MTux from Bass Pro Shops.
Howdy, howdy.
And then we have Prodigy from the MRT.
Yours truly.
All right. And that's everyone here. So without further ado, I think it's time to get started and talk about the games we had last week. Because we had some pretty interesting games. We had 2-3-0s and then 2-3-2s. And we start from the bottom of the bracket. We'll see that MRT started off with a 3-0 over Big Fish Gaming Marlin. Where Prodigy decided his other teammates didn't need to play this week and just swept them out of the way. So congratulations on that, Prodigy.
Thank you. Thank you. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. And I noticed that your lineup this week that you were playing, you played Pantheon Vayne, Alawi Slain, the Gnar Teemo Triss Champion Strength.
Yep.
What led you to come up with that lineup? Curious.
Yeah, we were, you know, you just do your job scouting, and in the scouting we had a few things. One was to figure out, is the new 2-drop in Pantheon broken? Turns out it's pretty strong, so we abused that. We only have one day to come around with the patch. You're kind of just trying to figure out if any of the new stuff is really powerful, if any of the old stuff didn't get nerfed. And then it just lined up to what they've been playing a lot of, so we wanted stuff that could handle their. They played a lot of set karma, and played a lot of Kai'Sa. So we just wanted a lineup that could beat Kai'Sa and Karma. And yeah, I just brought some good decks, stuff that wasn't anything similar to what I played in the previous weeks. And it just happened that I matched up very well into their entire team. So
yeah, I would say it wound up being pretty successful. And yeah, because you wound up getting the sweep over them.
Yep.
And yeah, like you said, you want to beat Karma's set and Kai'Sa, and there was two Karma sets and a Kai'Sa there, so your scouting was spot on.
Yep. So yeah, it's been cool. I've been enjoying the season a lot. I feel like the meta's in a really good place. There's a lot of flexibility in terms of the mid range and decks you can play. So I've been able to bring a different lineup the last 3 weeks in a row, just like completely different decks. So
nice. That's nice. We'll have to see next week if we're gonna increase it to 4, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. I got plenty of stuff in the tank. People think I'm a mid range only player, but truth be told, there's a lot of mid range decks. So
exactly. Yeah. You make them think you're more than just a mid range only player. Then you play mid range and surprise them, right?
I play Demacia not because I love Demacia as a region, but because Demacia beats the regions that I hate. So,
and that's the correct way to play. What are your for everyone else, what are your guys' thoughts on this outcome that we have here?
I mean, yeah, you kind of just brought good decks, and your good deck beat their good decks. There's not a whole lot to say. I mean, yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, I think this is a 3-0 lineup for sure. Like, all of your decks can beat a variety of decks. They're all pretty flat, and they all have game into everything. So it makes sense to me.
I guess only the Panther way, unless it's kind of Zeus, but sure. I don't mind the lineup.
Yeah. All right. Yep.
The Pantheon list definitely wasn't optimized, but when you have one day to turn it around, it's all right.
Everyone did, so.
Yeah. And it's not like Pantheon Vayne had as much of a blueprint to go off of, since no one was really playing that before the patch, you know?
Yeah. We've got updated lists, though, for this week, if we, for some reason, want to bring them.
Exactly. Yeah. But speaking of who you're going to be playing this week, we have the other side of the bracket, which is about Bass Pro Shops against TSP. And this one was a bit closer. We had a 3-2 here. We almost had the sweep from Seth here. But Seth decided he wanted to... Seth got a little too lost in the sauce, as they would say, in his music selection. And then it wound up having to come down to Aikato taking out the last player and moving him on to the next round. So what are your thoughts on this series, MTuck?
I'm so sad about this series. Cephalopod misses lethal in game one of round 3, which is like whatever, it happens to everyone. And then I go in and I'm like insane favorite. Like I have a 62 to 65% spread on every non-ban deck. And Hawk draws the perfect Kai'Sa curve with Kata to back it up. And I'm just like, all right, well, I guess I'm just not playing this game. That was fun. And then Aikido has, I think, a 30% average spread into the Hawk and manages to like just win pretty like convincingly. I was like, all right, you know what? Screw matchups. Just be a good player next time. Bring good decks.
Yeah.
I learned my lesson. Time to shape up for next week.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty sure against Aikido, Hawk was going for the evolve-less evolve game plan, and it turns out it was not as successful.
Yeah, no, I mean, like, I'm happy overall. Like, obviously, we won, which is great, but it should have been a lot more convincing, either 3-0 or 3-1. And so I'm kind of proud of things to improve.
Yep. And they got a big chance to show up this week against the MRT. So that's going to be who you're facing this week. And MRT's coming pretty hot off the 3-0. You guys have the 3-2, so there's a little bit of momentum there. But I think this will be a very interesting matchup, because I think both of you guys were very favored in your groups when you were placed in them. And now you're showing up here in the Final Four. I think that was to be expected. I think, honestly, both teams were rated quite highly in the preseason rankings. And, hey, you guys made it this far, so congratulations to both of you. But let's get to the important part of this. Is what would you have to say to your opponents this week? I'll start with you, MTux.
What do I have to say to my opponents? I mean, like, it's not much of a match. I'm kind of just gonna like we're gonna win. Like, this is like, I'm not worried. This is an easy set.
Okay. Well, we'll see. I mean, you know, when the worst player on your team can sweep a match, it speaks pretty highly of your team and your strengths. So I'm excited. We got Kever. We got Santa. We got some really good scouters. Yeah, I think our team lineup building is best it's ever been. So I'm very confident in our team to navigate, to build some really good lineups that are very cohesive. So I'm excited. It'll be a good palate cleanser before the finals.
Yeah, trash talk away. I actually am like really excited for this set. It'll be a good fun one. It's like a lot of good players playing a lot of good players, so it'll be good fun.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm very much looking forward to it, even just as a spectator. It's gonna be a great set. Just to watch everyone go at it. Just to like watch the replays and stuff. You'll be able to learn a lot from the games. During and after.
Mm-hmm. And you know what? So I get some insight from the other side of the bracket. Chekov and Baja, what are your guys' predictions for this series? Obviously, MTux and Prodigy are going to be a little bit biased for their outcome. Well, why don't you go first,
well,
Chekov?
I guess I'm going to start. When I see the teams, like, unless like I don't see how like Basper Shop wins, honestly, I don't know. I kind of also like kind of sus. So I think Mustang Hunter gets this one kind of easily.
All right. What do you think, Chekov?
I think I'm also favoring MRT, but I wouldn't say easily at all. I think that, you know, BPS is going to do some prep, and I'm kind of interested to see what they're going to do. Because, you know, Prodigy has, you know, told us all that he's going to play one of the many, many flavors of midrange. But, you know, they're all players that have tons of range, you know, deck oceans, so... I'm really excited to see, like, I hope somebody pulls out something really spicy for this one.
Yeah. And for my prediction here, I think I'm going to have to go with Bass Pro Shops, because MRT beat us, and I want Bass Pro Shops to beat them. I'm definitely not biased when I say that. But, yeah, Bass Pro Shops has some good players, like Cephalopod's insane, MTux I've known for a long time in the community, he's been really good. Akato's been able to show up and talk sometimes, and hey, you know what? He was able to clutch it out last week, so maybe he'll come in and clutch it out this week again. And, you know, MRT, I think they are good players, like Prodigy won a seasonal, and everyone else is quite good, and they did beat our team, but, you know, I want them to lose the BPS, so that's what I'm going to go with. No hard feeling, guys.
Yeah, not taken. We just keep busting brackets. I thought it was hilarious when the community had us unfavored in the first round of playoffs.
I mean, hey, it wound up going to 3-2. So it's not like it was an easy road.
No. It was funny, though. That was the first team call we had all season. We didn't do a single prep meeting the entire season. Most seasons, we just submit decks about 10 minutes before the round until playoffs, and then playoffs come, we actually try hard. So...
That's when the last word of your name shows up, right?
Yeah. We try hard in playoffs.
Yeah. All right. All right, thank you guys very much. I think with that, we can go on to the upper side of the bracket, where we have, or rather the left side of the bracket, where we have Red Pup Games versus Big Fish Gaming Bass. It's a 3-0 from RPG here. Gouda wound up sweeping them with Jinx Samira, Teemo Tristana, and Heimerdinger Jace. Once again, Dr. Chekov does not get to play the game Legends of Runeterra. What are your thoughts on that, Chekov?
Well, you know, let me just put it this way. BBBSS should know who's going first next week, because I'm the only one who hasn't got a sweep. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, I see.
So just be expecting the Chekov sweep this week.
Yeah. Chekov says it's his turn now.
Yep.
Cute.
I mean, Gouda just went off, as he often does. He's a great player. He can diff on every deck. Probably the hardest match was like the very, very first one. But as soon as he beat Alex, it was like, no, sorry, I forget who went first. Yeah, it was Alex. Okay.
Yep.
It was just like free, easy sailing, because at that point, even if Guda lost, we just had like, you know, two counters, basically two counter lineups ready to go. So,
yeah. And you know what? It's also kind of interesting as well to see like some of the differences in the lineups as well, because we have like, because Guda also brought Teemo Tristana champion strength, but Guda is still playing the Bandle Gunners, whereas Prodigy cut the Bandle Gunners from his list. So it's interesting to see how different teams made different calls for deck lists as well. And you know what? Both of them showed some major success with their decks as well, considering they both got their sweeps. So interesting to see how what the adaptation is for next week, because this is like a day after the patch, obviously. So lists weren't as refined, and I expect next week people will probably have a bit better of an idea for what they want to be playing, and what cards are just not good enough to make the cut.
Yeah, I'm sorry we couldn't show the spice. You know, we brought like a Timer Jace Bandle deck and never got to show it off. So
triple condensed, man. You know, I really hope that they're confident sticks with them, because yeah, I want to see more of these condensed decks.
Like, all right, can I just say condensed on Albus Pharaoh seems so funny. And same thing with Hextech Handler. Oh my god. Wow. Yeah, I want to see that deck next week. Hang on a second.
Not going to say we broke the meta, but yeah. You know, what are you going to say?
Hey, you know what? It was so good. Didn't even have to play to win the series, you know?
That's right. Those are the best kind of decks.
Exactly. Hey, you brought six of them so far. Yeah, all right. So we got Red Pups coming in this week. You guys want to have any thoughts on this series?
I basically, like, just kind of makes sense what Chekhov said about the, like, I'm looking at just the matchups, and Alexander looks like a hard set for Guda. Like, I kind of wish I could see that pod to see how that went, because I would assume Alexander was favored. But after that, like, yeah, it's kind of either, like, it's at worst 50 for Guda for the other two. Quite favored probably in the Moth, so yeah, I don't know.
Like, Guda just diffs with Hammer Jace. Like every matchup that you think is unfavored, he just wins. So that's how it goes.
Yeah, I can see that actually. He is kind of like a PNZ control player, like between SI and Targon.
Yeah, hey, you know what? Hammer Jace didn't get better this patch because it didn't get nerfed. As quite a few of the other decks did. Yeah, I think the Bandle Gunners nerf really helped it out, because they had a hard time dealing with that. So now that that's gone, there's less units that are going to be good against SI removal. So, yeah. Congratulations to Guda, and we'll see if you can keep up this, if RPG can keep up the success next week against their opponent, BBBSS, who was our streamed match last week against ABG Piltover. And while being a banger of a series, and it came down to the last game, and it finished with a 3-2 scoreline for EVSS. So what do you want to talk about for this series, Bajatok?
Well, like, this series was pretty close. I think our opponent was kind of turning, to be honest. So unless, like, it was maybe closer than it should have been. I think we maybe kind of underestimated the prep, I'm going to be honest with you. But yeah, otherwise, I think we played pretty well. But yeah, our opponent didn't show up that much, so we took that down. Something that I took notes from that week was like that I'm gonna make BB play actually good decks this week. So because I have no clue what garbage decks he's play. And you know, it's like just a thingy. But otherwise, it was good series.
I noticed that he's on Ornn Vayne over Jax Ornn, which I thought was pretty interesting. I know that Jax
Ornn. He promised me the deck is good, so I believed him. He's on a lot of decks, so we will see what we're gonna bring, but we're definitely like stepping up our prep now, because like we also were kind of ill. Like Simon didn't almost see on his monitor last week. PB was giga ill, and I was also giga ill, so like, you know, we're stepping up, we actually scrimming finally now, so
scrimming for your scrimming to prep? Who does that?
Yeah, we didn't do that before, so like, I don't know. But yeah, we're just gonna be much better this week, definitely.
All right. And yeah, I did notice for ABG Piltover that they wound up going with an interesting strat, which is bring two of the same lineup. So that way, if you have, which I think is a, it's a bit more interesting in playoffs, because in playoffs, if someone's favored into that, it can be, get a little bit dicey. But I guess if you start with it, you can kind of lose the unfavored one, beat them with the favored one next, and then go back to that lineup in the end. But it looks like, unfortunately for them, it did not pay off this week, because Baja's team just took them down. All right. Did you, anyone else want to add anything for their thoughts on this series?
I mean, look, it's a 3-2 where they brought Nasus, Jax, Orin, J4, Shen, like, as two of their lineups. I mean, let's just start the trash talk here. Like, how is that not a 3-0 series, right? Those are not good decks.
If you notice, one of the decks is, you know, it's one of the decks that he brought is On Rain. That's pretty brilliant. That's
like, oh, yeah, no, Broken Ball.
Second deck that we have is Kaiser. Yeah. That's also poor. This is anti Kaiser lineup, isn't it kind of clear? So, So like,
but you have to get that.
Even I have beaten it twice, once. Like, that's the worst thing. But yeah, sure, I can see. But I also did some questionable things, to be honest.
Yeah, I think this series was just a reason of, like, this season just showed, like, why some of the best players that are consistently topping events are, like, some of the best players, because, like, people will draw bad hands or have unfavored matchups, but they're not throwing the game away, and they're still, like, closing the game up. They're still playing to win. They're not maybe, like, saving the game, but they're definitely not throwing the game. And on the other side, you have unfortunate misplays or mistakes or oversights. And you make one or two mistakes in a match like that, and you can take what is a winning position, and very quickly you can find yourself in an unfortunate spot. And I think we just saw that, like, just the ability to, like, consistently not dig yourself into a hole is often what separates consistency in, like, longer tournaments.
I think especially my, like, Kaiser into Vaifeng Nasus was kind of one of the credits. Even though I lost that game, it was kind of showcasing how, like, I was just outscaling my opponent. But it actually seems so much doomed for me. I was able almost to win it. I was, like, one off. And then I almost won it if he didn't have exactly the one vengeance. So, like, that was just the showcase of...
Oh, yeah, that was, like, the game where he obliterated his Nasus.
No, that wasn't. That was against Leo, I think. Yeah. Against Vaifeng, it was the last game with Kaiser. That wasn't the obliterated game. That was the different game.
Oh, really?
I think
that was the one where the Rekindler... No, okay.
No, that was different. That was that was game before or something. But the game that I'm talking about is, like, he was playing actually, like, I was doing some small mistake, but he didn't do this, like, significant one. But still, I was almost able to pull off the game off. But it's like, definitely I do agree that, like, this season is kind of interesting to see that, like, somebody talked about it, like, actually the top four teams before the season are actually in top four. So that's actually pretty hype, to be honest. And I'm really looking forward for the semis and finals, because I think it's gonna be some hype games, and I think the best out of the best is just fighting each other kind of hype.
Yeah, I have to say,
upsets are hype, but this is actually even more hype in some ways. Like, we just get, like, the four best teams and we get to duke it out. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, you know, seeing the best players fight against each other is always entertaining. And go ahead, MTux.
I'm really interested to see how the prep goes into your semis match, Baja, because Piltover hardcore out prepped you guys. Like, I saw these matchups and I'm like before you guys made your set, and I was like, I know BBVSS is the better players, but I'm pretty sure, like, from a matchup only perspective, once I saw who was going first and whose side, that I would have put this at, like, 65% Piltover. Like, they hardcore out prepped you guys. So.
We had even less time than you guys did, right? Because we for us, Pedge was Wednesday night, and, you know, we're sending the lineup Thursday night, so it's kind of hard for us to do it in the one day window to do the prep for us, even harder than for you, because you have not only have War Day or Wednesday, because it's getting early for you, as well as having the War Day Thursday, right? So that's something.
It just also goes to show that, like, just because you line up diff someone, you have to be able to, like, play the decks very well that you bring, right? Like, just because something on paper is a statistically good matchup, if you don't have the reps to actually make it favored, then it might be worth, it might be better to bring comfort sometimes over a lineup diff, because you're just going to lose points to play. So always also, think about.
I feel like this is very revealing of how you view the game. When I look at these lineups, I don't see a lineup diff. I see people bringing Nasus and Jax Ornn and Jarvan Shen, three inconsistent decks in the same lineup, right? Like at some point, those decks are just going to brick. It doesn't matter how favored you are. These decks are going to let you down.
Yes.
You show up. you watch Kever win Jarvan Shen into Nasus and fatigue the Nasus. Maybe you can play this deck pretty well and it's actually not as bad as we think.
Yeah, I wonder who that Nasus player could have been. The world may never know. But yeah. So speaking of the matchups though, next week, the match we are gonna have on stream will be the BBB SS versus Red Pup Games. Anything you want to say here? I'll start with you, Chekov.
Well, I think I already said what I was going to say is that I'm going to go first and I'm going to 3-0. If you just look at the record, right? We went 9-0 in groups. So far, we haven't lost a single game in playoffs. I don't anticipate we will lose any games. So that's kind of what I'm thinking. I'm thinking it's just going to be 9-0, 12-0. So.
All right. Pasha, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, Shigar, if you look at the playoff stats and groups, there were two undefeated people. It was me and it was you. I think that this is my time to 3-0. I think I proved it multiple times that when it matters the most, I step up. So, okay. It's my time for 3-0.
All right. You and me, we'll go first. Gentlemen's agreement.
Yeah, that does sound pretty hype, I will say.
Pinky promise.
Yeah, and if you want to see this matchup, it will be next, this Friday. We'll be starting at 7 p.m. EST, so come and catch the games. It'll be quite exciting. With that, we have everything done for the top bracket, so do you guys want to talk about the consolation bracket at all?
Mostly we didn't have a choice.
Yeah, exactly. No, you're stuck here. Yep. So we have 2-3-0s, a 3-1, and then our only 3-1 actually, and then a 3-2 between Targan's Valley and Tron. So I guess we can start with Crowstorm versus Duckpeak. Kwako decided he wanted his team to go home early that day because he just 3-0'd Crowstorm. And he brought Echo Jinx, Fizz Samira, and then Garen, J4, Kai'Sa. What are you guys' thoughts on this outcome?
Well, he has 3,000 LP, so I'm pretty sure he has like three times the LP they have at least on Crowstorm. So I think if that's how you're calculating it, it kind of makes sense that he'd 3-0.
Also, like it's only Kai'Sa player that doesn't copy my list, so... it's something. As well, like, you know, it's a duck pig that everyone was saying that, you know, we're gonna lose to, so I'm happy to see them win because I think they're pretty good, and even though we destroy them, that's also showing us that we are maybe even better, right?
Yeah, exactly. Hey, you know what? If they wind up coming in six, it only shows that, you know, you guys beat the best team that lost round one, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, of course I'm put up, but Crowstorm put up a good fight, but they are going to be out next week. So, thank you. So, best of luck to them. And I guess I can go to the next one, which is Chip versus Main Pirates. I believe for this matchup, one of the players on Main Pirates did have to concede one of their matches, so they weren't able to play. But yeah, Chip did in the end take it home with a 3-0. So,
yeah, this was interesting. I mean, obviously unfortunate that Pirates had to not play a player, but like Roji brought the most Roji decks Roji could possibly bring. So I'm kind of surprised they didn't like prep for that. I guess like this is like face up. These are three decks that have Roji's stamp of I play these decks.
Yep. Yeah. And for those at home, it's Set Viego, Talia Malphite, and then Pantheon Vayne.
Okay, to be fair though, I think this is a pretty good call. Like Roji matches up well into, like Roji playing Roji decks matches up really well into what main pirates have been bringing all season. They brought a lot of control, and they brought a lot of Demacia. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They varied it up a little bit this week, but not enough. And the decks that they brought were kind of bad, like Jack Set and, I don't know, Akshan Echo, whatever that is. So it kind of makes sense to me that Roji would sweep this because his style of deck and the kind of deck he's really good at playing is just really good into what the main pirates have been bringing all season.
I'm looking at this go ahead, Vaja.
Yeah, they also kind of overcooked. They play pack attack in the deck, so
I was about to talk about that. They're playing the full cat package, so they can play pack attack, and they're also main decking two called shots. So they get this free attack with their cats. I think that's really funny.
Is this Broken Ball deck or what? Hello?
Oh hey, I found out what Broken Ball's playing next week. I mean, who knows?
Yeah, this is one of his, man. Like, this is that's something that he came up with, and he's like, man, this deck is so good. And I'm like, okay, let's scrim it. And he went 0-5.
I mean, it's good enough to bring, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, unfortunate for main pirates that they... circumstance, but congratulations to Chip for moving on to the semifinals for the consolation bracket. So I guess we can go on to the next matchup, which was ABG Noxus versus Tactical Kinku Guild. ABG Noxus managed to get the 3-1 here over them. And yeah, we have Nora Viego from Rogio. That was really the only person who brought that deck, and he's even playing Ross of the Sunner, which is a bit of a blast from the past, but in the end, ABG Noxus had played quite well, and they managed to get there over PKG. Do you guys have any thoughts on this matchup?
Not really. This kind of just makes sense. ABG Noxus, good team. They're good players. I thought then between DSP and round one of playoffs was like a toss-up. So, yeah, it just makes sense that they did well.
Yep.
Condense is a good card in Nora Viego. I've been playing that in Eternal. So is Grave Companion. These are all good cards in the deck. But there's a reason I'm playing it in Eternal.
Yeah.
This team needs Vile Feast, man.
And also no Poke Stick either.
Yeah, it's gonna be so weird to play standard, you know, because like, you don't have to be playing around different cards than in the turn now.
Yeah, it's always fun to go to Eternal and just think, oh, they're playing Broadman Pile. Yeah, whatever. It's not that great. And then you get flocked and you remember, oh wait, no, this is the good version of the deck.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep. And then we move on to the last matchup here, which was Tron versus Targon's Valley. It was a 3-2 in the end. And as the representative from Targon's Valley, I can honestly say I have no idea how we got there. I was out this week, so I was not able to actually catch any of the games. But I know that in the end, Griff came in clutch and closed things out for us. And
you brought Lurk-based classic.
Conchon Lurk is something, man. Except for when he puts 4/6 drops in his hand. That's not great.
But didn't he lose to us with Vedetta? I think he always lose to us with the Lurk. But I guess you're the only team that beaten us in group, so I guess.
Exactly,
you're actually the only team that beaten us.
Okay, but is this a Targon's Valley win, or is this Tron overcooking? Like, look at their decks.
Hey, yeah, man,
this is 100% Tron overcooking.
Hey, man, all I'm saying is... The set Mirror Mage deck looks pretty sick on paper, all right?
Yeah, we've got Ken and Samira. They're just really abusing the best champion in the game in Samira, and we're taking a blast from the past with this Ken.
Yeah, and then we're playing Diana LeBlanc because we wanted to play Ramen Pile, but we couldn't play Samira. So we put the next best thing in.
Ken and Samira was a tested deck, and it was a 38% win rate deck. I'm not saying like there's a good combo it can do, right? But I'm just, I would be disappointed if I were trying to be a competitive player and then I overcooked this hard, you know? Like, maybe it's just consolation bracket and it's fun. That's probably it, honestly. I shouldn't be overanalyzing this. They're having fun. It's the consolation bracket.
Yeah, why
and they even won, you know, 2-3s, so it's not a problem.
Yeah.
Why would you play mono set when you can play, like, set combo, right? Like, let's be honest on that.
And, well,
like,
because you can... the mono set deck has its own, like, interesting, I guess, combo with the Cobra. The idea is that when you play, like, Cobra, and then you condense on a Cobra, it copies Cobra, and, like, this...
Oh, my God, yeah.
And then you get really big units. Woo!
I don't know. I think I should, honestly, but it's fine. Good luck.
I mean, the other combo was with Mirror Mage, condensing Mirror Mage, and all of a sudden your coins get, like, quadrupled and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but, like, when you have infinite mana, do you need more infinite mana?
I mean, yeah, but, like, putting four spells in the stack when you go play Perilous Pastry is really funny. If you consider that, M-Tux.
You know what? You're right. I have not considered the funniness of the deck. I tend to consider the weaker deck.
No, I mean, I think it's not just funny. Like, Condensed Mirror Mage does win the game pretty fast. Like, if you get that combo, it wins much quicker than other similar combos. But it's just getting there, right? It's a Mirror Mage deck. You have to get to turn 8. And it is less good than Karmaset in getting to late game.
Yeah, and then you also have to kind of get to turn 9 because you need to be able to condense it and then actually play the unit. Well, I guess actually coins can help you do that in the same turn because you can coin... And then you can actually have the unit mana to play it. That actually probably helps a little bit.
I don't know. I've just played against this kind of deck like a lot on ladder, and like in the last like 2 or 3 weeks. I found that like when they get Mirror Mage out, it's like cool. They do a lot of things, but then they run out of cards in hand because they don't. Their draw is not nearly as good as the Karma Flip because they don't double the draw. And so it's like cool. You have infinite mana to do whatever you have in your hand, but you've been playing your hand to survive. So. Good luck.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, and then Targon's Valley, ABG Noxus, Church of Targon, and Duck Peak made it onto the semifinals, the Constellation bracket, and they're going to be joined by the four teams that lost in the upper bracket, which are BFG Marlin, TSP, Team Space Bloggers, Big Fish Gaming Bass, and then ABG Piltover. So we have our matchups for next week, which is Duck Peak versus Big Fish Gaming Marlin, Church of Targon versus Team Space Poggers, Always Be Gaming Noxus versus Big Fish Gaming Bass, and then Targon's Valley versus Always Be Gaming Piltover. Also, you guys have any... I guess we can start with Duck Peak versus Marlin. Do you guys have any predictions for this matchup here?
I'm going Duck Peak 3-1.
Duck Peak, yeah. Duck Peak 3-0 again. Kawako is pretty good.
Yeah, Kawako is... Kawako just did 3,000 LP, and he did just sweep Crowstorm. I think Kawako stocks are at a pretty big high right now. I'll go in on the hype and say Duck Peak's probably going to take this series as well.
I'm going to predict 3-2 to Marlin. I think this will be a close series. I think that the Marlin players are pretty underrated. And they can absolutely take games off these Duck Peak players. I think all the Duck Peak players are very good, but will they be as motivated? Will they be, you know, coming off a nice 3-0 where they didn't have to play? You know, who knows?
Yeah, will they be only playing Eternal this week? Who knows?
Mm.
All right. Then next up, we have Chip versus Team Space Poggers. For this series, I'm going to have to go with Team Space Poggers getting it 3-1. I have faith in James and James's team take out Chip this week. And it was a very, very close series against Bass Pro Shops after Hawk brought it back. So Hawk can play like that again this week. I think they'll have no problems taking out Chip.
I would also go with TSP. I think they were pretty good in groups, honestly. I think they were. I think our group so we're gonna take it all honestly. So, group run power, and I think TSP is gonna take it.
Yeah, actually, you know what? Another thing is really funny is if TSP and Targon's Valley win their matches this week and next week, three of the six teams in the final standings will be from Group One.
Yeah, exactly. Well, all the winners are gonna be, you know, it's gonna be you 5th, 6th, you know, and then we're gonna be the first, you know. So like,
Yeah, we can say we would have gotten first if it wasn't for the fact that BBSS was in our group, you know?
Exactly.
I also think that TSP will take it. I think it'll be pretty close, but I think just looking at the lineups from last week, it's clear that TSP wants to bring good decks and Church wants to bring bad decks. I mean, that's a little bit flippant, but what I guess I really mean is that I think that FGW, again, is in his arc of actually playing really well and playing real decks, and I hope that continues. I hope they don't, you know, just have fun with it because it's consolation bracket. I hope they, you know, keep a nice competitive series.
Yep, I was going to say 3-2 Space Poggers for a lot of similar reasons I've mentioned. We actually had Space Poggers rated pretty highly when we were picking teams for who we wanted to play in the first round. We tried to avoid them pretty highly, so yeah, a lot of respect for them.
Yeah, sounds about right. Then going on to the next match, we have ABG Noxus versus BFG Bass. So what are your guys' predictions for this one? I'll say these two are probably the teams on here I know the least about. So I'm thinking I'm just going to predict a 3-1 for ABG Noxus because those players have been putting up pretty solid results, and I don't know as much about the Bass players, honestly.
I want to say it's either going to be a 3-2 for Noxus or a 3-0 for Bass. Because Alexander is either going to like win three games or they're going to lose and not. It's like, this will be bad.
Yeah, I have no clue about these players, so I'm gonna, yeah. I don't know. I'm gonna go at Big Fish Gaming, I don't know. It's 3-2, I don't know.
Yeah, right. I would lean ABG Noxus, just because I know Jaylu and Rodeo are pretty decent, but I don't have super strong feelings. I haven't played either of these teams in a while.
So stylistically, based on like lineups, I think Big Fish is actually favored, but I do think that ABG Noxus, you know, has some very good players, and they might be able to either, you know, change stylistically and play some slightly different deck options, or they might just be able to win those unfavored matchups. But I do think that Big Fish might have an edge if they continue, you know, if both teams bring the same lineups they brought last week, right? I think I'd give the edge to BFG, but I'm excited to see what ABG Noxus can come up with.
All right. Let me go on to the last matchup at the consolation bracket, which is Targon's Valley versus ABG Piltover. I am predicting for this series a 3-1 for Targon's Valley. I think Conch and team are going to be cooking up some wild stuff this week, and we'll have to see what they end up bringing.
When you say you guys are cooking, that makes me want to go 3-1 the other way. Because Conch is cooking sometimes, like, I think Conscious Lurk is better than Conscious Cookie. So I'm gonna go with 3-1 Piltover.
Yeah, I
agree, but I also don't want to play Conch when he's cooking, because he either has the best deck or the worst deck. Me and Tank still have PTSD when we got swept by Dragons back in season one in the first round of playoffs.
Yeah, but that's just Conch playing well, like, that he's good at Dragons is just him being good at the game. Like, I don't want to see, I don't know, his terrible Swain Lowy list again. I don't know. I don't want to see like the stuff he's playing. Like, I want to see him play good decks and win. Yet again, this is the spiciest match of the week, as it always is with Targon's Valley. Every single match, yeah. Targon's Valley, we've been like, oh, this is the match to watch. Every single week.
I think Targon's Valley they're good players, and even if Conch is brewing, I think he'll have the advantage of not being able to, like, I don't know that ABG is going to be able to figure out what his decks do. I think
some teams will
look at lineups and get reps in and scrim before to, like, understand how the matchup plays out. I have a feeling that Targon's Valley is going to know their matchups.
It's 3-0 to ABG Piltover.
Oh, wow. No faith in
I was going to say 3-1 for Targon's Valley.
I have to go 3-0 for Targon Valley. It's a good one again. Yeah. And it's Conch getting double pike predict, you know. It's the classic.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Well, we got some divided opinions here, but we'll have to see which one is going to round out here for the consolation bracket. Winners of these matches will go on to compete for getting the chance for 5th-6 next week. There's no other teams that are going to be going into the consolation bracket. If one of the teams in the top bracket loses, they will instead compete. They will instead be going for 3rd-4th. And then the winners of those matches obviously will fight for 1st and 2nd in the league. And it's going to be pretty exciting. I'm excited for playoffs to be going to our top 4 teams. And I'm excited to see who ends up being our top 2 and how bad my pick'ems end up being.
Truly excited for the rematch. We're ready for the rematch this time. I won't be stuck in the airport. That's all I'm saying. Man, we run that series back against RPG. If we don't have to telegraph that I'm going in first pick before the match starts, and might end up in a different way. I'll just say that I'm looking forward to a rematch again. We got to get there first.
Yeah.
Now we've got Tank, so we have the trade.
Oh, you're right. It's 3-1. Just kidding. Tank will take it.
So the real question is, if when you guys play for 3rd and 4th, are you guys actually going to play for 3rd and 4th? Or are you guys going to, like, accept that 3rd and 4th is a tie?
Yeah. Like, good luck, Master and Gunther, and Red Pup in 3rd and 4th match, you know? We're going to make it with Memtex for the finals.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you all for joining me this week, and good luck to all of you in your respective matches. And we'll see who's going to come back next week when we do our recap show before the finals. Yeah, so with that, I will think it's about time to wrap things up. Thank you all for coming out and watching us today, and I hope everyone has a great night. See you later. Touch Mac. Touch Mac.